What's back there, Jezebel?
For dinner, huh?
Yeah.
What?
Crunchy. You missed him, though.
Well, it's a fat little booger. He's eating their dog chow, so.
Yeah.
Growing up healthy.
Growing up healthy.
Until she catches it someday. Which, by the way, that's the way nature works.
Damn nature.
Damn nature.
Well, I don't know. It's just you and me. What do you want to work on? We can clean these up and weld them in. We can go to the cargo. You know, working with the torch this morning sounds warmer. Let's do that.
Yes, it does.
Straighten up those things in the cargo hold.
A quick little update on our paint samples here. There's...
Oh, it's looking good. I filled put a little more water in here to bring the level up. So they're sitting partially in it. And I can see salt starting to build up on the tops of them, too. See this up here? It's salt spray. So that's what we want. And I doubt I see any failures so far.
Yeah, it'd be funny if he sat in here for a year and didn't have any problems. This is the Pour 15 sample, or one of them. And it looks good, too. Well, so far, so good. This is the one of the Australian ones. Oh, look at that. There's a little bit of rust down there on the corner showing through already. See, this is one that's brittle. It cracked real easy. Yeah. So it's got some damage down there. Now, covering the corners isn't really, it's not a good fair test, because covering the corners, not every corner is the same. And most paints don't cover over corners well, except for coal tar. It does a damn good job covering over. Now, this is coal tar over that Australian paint. See where it chipped loose? But we're not even developing rust or that, so it is, the base coat there is doing a good job of protecting like it should. But it's early. We'll see.
Okay, I'm gonna have to put more. You said you got some extension cords.
Yeah, locking extension cords.
We've got all locked.
Broke down and bought those damn things.
These things actually had a name and I can never remember it. But anyway, that's the way they work. The wedge goes in and the window goes forward and you're closed up.
I need a pair.
Thank you.
Too damn short, so it doesn't bend at all. I mean, if they had it hot, it didn't go. So we're putting some relief cuts in it, and that'll give us the ability to probably just bend it over with a brace. Get the bolt in then, and we can weld it back, and hopefully the weld doesn't pull it back too much.
Time to do the shoot out.
Where's the cookie?
Yeah.
And we're cutting the hole for the mast. What he's doing first is just cutting a smaller hole so we can make sure that everything's lined up right. There we go, one hole, small hole.
I thought he wanted to skip weld.
No, he's just doing it here, and then the idea is to, you know, to move down and keep the heat away. That's all I think.
Oh, okay.
So it is kind of a skip weld, but we're going to come back and fill in the holes. But you might let it cool a little bit. You're doing, I'd go work the other side anyway.
Yeah.
And let this cool down, then come back and get them.
Yeah.
So we're going to put the plumb bob straight down from if it was in the center of the mast. If the mast is on these lines.
It is hanging right where we expected it to, straight down the center of the boat. And we like that.
Here's one right here if you need one.
I was happy when I got the bulkhead to fit in that close though.
Yeah.
Fire the hole.
Fire the hole. Well done. Well done, guys. Yeah, that's good. That'll work. Cut this thing.
Not would, me.
Wait a minute. Cool. Go up with it.
I was down below grinding.
Thanks. Did you grind this at all yet?
No, I didn't.
Oh. Yeah, okay, it's gonna be alright. Go up. If you just grind it. Oh. You just grind it, it'll fit. Up. Nice. Well done.
Good luck with those rings.
I don't get decent weather. That's the main mast step going in. Somebody asked if we were going to put a coin under it. I don't know how you do that. The mast is hollow.
Alright, want me to open up the hatch and drop it down in here?
Yeah.
Alright.
Then we'll set up that ring around it.
I'll do that.
Yeah.
1, 2 here, this is coming off.
1.
That ring.
You weld fine. That's beautiful.
Bacteria, viruses, fungi, so small things. And then
I remember that, that's chapter 7. Yeah, it was, my freshman biology class, chapter 7. Rust, musts, and moles was the next chapter, I think.
Yeah, and then the next chapter is molecular biology, so it's how all the molecules interact and how they're formed and how there's the data.
Are you talking about proteins and?
Yeah, proteins, lipids, carbohydrates.
Oh, okay, yeah.
Oh, I used to know a couple of people like that.
This is, I know a few lipids in my life.
I feel the earth.
Damn it to hell, man. Completely rebuilding nearly a fiberglass boat up at Lake Uluga. Yeah.
Okay.
Thank you.
Beautiful.
That looks excellent.
Thinking about selling Seeker today. Boy, that's a big step, isn't it? To take a project that's this size and decide that for some reason you got to walk away from it. And I'm not going to do that. I'm not going to sell this boat. At least not today. Because I'm not that person. But I got a friend that is. And you know, it's such a hard thing to deal with. We get something like this going on, and you're so tied into it, and everybody sees that you're tied into it, that they think, you know, they start worrying that you're not going to finish, or that you know, what if something happens, and you know, all those. And I don't think about that much really. It's just like that's not what I see happening. But it does happen. You know, there's a lot of boats around, and if you want to get into a boat, you know, at a good price, you buy one that's partially completed, and that's a great way to get a boat that's you know, a bargain. And I got a friend that's got one of those, and it's you know, you feel sorry, but then you think, you know, I'm not living his life, and he could be doing exactly what he needs to do. In fact, if he's thinking about himself, and he should be, that is what he's doing. He's doing exactly what he needs to be doing. And we all think we're walking somebody else's path, and we should somehow be entitled to pass judgment or make decisions for them. But man, that is just bullshit. That didn't work for marriages. It didn't work for jobs. It doesn't work for anything. You need to be running your own show and making your own decisions. You know, you can ask me about codependency in marriage, and I can tell you that it's not a good thing. You know, in the long run, you're tearing yourself apart, or you're tearing the other person apart, probably both. And getting out of it is a great thing. Back to, you know, some people come up to me and say, "Oh, you advocate divorce." Damn straight I do. And it's like, it's okay to advocate marriage and being bound to somebody even though it's not working for either of you, but it's not okay to advocate a healthier position, which is a separation from that person and walking your own path and letting them walk their own path. I'm sorry, but you know, I'm going to keep disappointing you. But God, we pass such judgment against people. It's like, you know, he quit or he didn't get through it. And man, that's exactly what I would feel. But you think about, why do you feel that way? Why do we feel that way when we have a, you know, a project car or a project boat or a plans that we bought to build something laying on our table and we never got to it?
Why do we beat ourselves up for that? And the only thing I can come up with is we do it because other people make us do it. Or they, you know, you're pressured into thinking that, you know, I should be doing this. And because I'm going to let these people down. And it's like, no, that's a horrible reason to do it. If I had to drive myself to work on this boat because I was going to, you know, displease viewers on YouTube or people who have contributed time or money to it, I'd be the wrong person for it. You know, I could make myself do it, but I'd have to do a shitty job. And I'd be horrible at doing it, and nobody'd like working with me if I wasn't feeling good about it. So, now that's not a good way to make decisions or lead your life. And I'm real proud of Paul. Paul's my buddy, and he has the sister ship to this. At least that's what I think of it is. It's a same hull, basically. Jack Carson drew both of the lines for his boat and mine, and I went and saw Paul's boat. I have a video of it. That's an old video, so it's lousy. I've gotten better at the video thing. It's kind of like welding. You know, you do enough of it, you're bound to get a little bit better, right? But take a look at it. And tell you what, if you want to get into a boat, I mean, get an accelerated dream at a bargain price, $50,000 is what he's asking, and he's got the hull ready to sandblast, paint, and fit out. So you got little to no steel work left to do on that thing. It's sitting halfway up Vancouver Island in Comox. And, oh God, what a beautiful place. You know, get yourself a rental there in the summer and go up and work on the boat and or live there year round if you can, you know, don't mind working in the cold. And you could really be out there in the water in a couple of years or less. Depends on, you know, how much time and effort you put in on it. And I would love to meet the person that wants to do that. But at the same time, I'm still proud of Paul, you know, because with all the social pressures we have to not do this, he's doing it anyway. He's doing what's right for him. And that takes, I think, a hell of a lot of courage. It really does.